Somebody just say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's worship him this morning. He's so good.
A lame man sat outside the gates, banging arms of those that entered in. Peter and John, they came upon him, the lame man expecting from them. Peter said, silver and gold I have none, but such I have I give unto thee. Right then the Spirit touched the man, he leaped to his feet and said, look what God's done for me.
Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body, he touched my mind, he saved me just in time. I'm gonna praise his name.
Come on and praise him.
Each day he's just the same. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done.
I was bound by chains of darkness and sin, had no hope and no peace of mind. Though my sin was red as scarlet, he washed me white as snow and he opened up my blinded eyes. Now my soul will rejoice, cause I've made up my choice, got this joy in everything that's within. My name's been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Can't you see what God's done for me?
Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. I'm gonna praise his name.
Come on and praise him.
Each day is just the same. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done.
Praise him in the morning.
Praise him
in the noontime.
Praise
with
him.
Your hand lifted high.
Praise him. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. I'm gonna praise his name.
Come on and praise him.
Each day he's just the same. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to praise his name this morning. He's so good. We've seen healings this month, stuff I've never seen before. You can't tell me my God's not real.
Amen.
You can't tell me he's not real. You can't tell me he's not faithful. You can't tell me he's not good. You cannot tell me he can't be in peace or comfort or joy. He's been that for me. He has been by my side through every second, through every day, through every trial. Through every good moment, he has been with me, and he never changes. Amen. He never changes. He looks better and better every single day,
Amen.
But he doesn't change. I'm just knowing him more. Amen. And you can know him more,
That's
and
right.
he can get so much more real to you. And no matter where you are, no matter what kind of situation you're in, find time to praise. Find time to worship.
Yes.
Find time to glorify him because
Amen.
He is good.
Amen.
He is faithful and he is good. I just want to bless his name this morning. Bless his name with me this morning.
In prisoner's chains with bleeding stripes. Pray that night.
You, because you are good. You are worthy, Jesus. You are worthy of praise. You are worthy of honor. I give up my life to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise your name, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Seems like all I could see was the struggle. Set me free.
Everybody said, I am redeemed, bought back, paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. Look at your neighbor and tell him, God has you and as much of you as you'll give up to him. How many know he's got a way and makes a way where there seems to be no. Anybody enjoying the presence of the, just enjoying his presence this morning? Amen. Let's give the praise team an appreciation. Love you so much. God has got great things in store. Everybody say this with me. Welcome winter, snow, ice, fall. Okay, so you're not going to be real. I don't know how you feel about it, but I talked to a pastor friend a few days ago. He said, we're having 90-plus degree weather in California, the hottest weather we've had all year. And I just said, you didn't have to say any of that. But having known the Lord has got great things in store for us, whatever the weather, he's Lord all by himself. Maybe see it if you like this morning. Is anybody blessed this morning? How many of you are blessed by faith or just in advance? You know something good is on the way. I want to share some things this morning that I really feel will encourage and strengthen us, because we're living at a very, I think everybody knows this, even the world is talking about it, that we're living in a very critical time. We're living in a time like I have not witnessed in my life. I've been through a lot of circumstance, traveled to different places in the world, but I've never gone through what we're going through now, where there seems to be a real attack against faith. And we're not talking about just in the world system. We're talking about the body of Christ is going to have to wake up to the place where we believe all the time. Say it with me, I'm going to believe all the time. Whatever comes, I'm going to stop and say, wait a minute, let me analyze this. Do I trust the enemy or am I going to believe God? I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall, on Sunday, continually be upon my lips. How many of you know if you walk in that kind of relationship with God, then you won't have anything to worry about anymore? Am I like to just live in peace? How many of you are not quite there yet, but you believe it's for you? I want you to go to the Word of God, if we can, for just a little while today. I want to share with you a couple of areas of Scripture that are very, very important. And I feel like it's important for us right now. I want you to go, if you will, to Galatians 5 and 17. Then we're going to go to Matthew 17. This morning, there are some exciting things in the air because God is speaking the answer. Thank you. I was waiting on just one. I just needed one. How many know the Lord has the answer because He is the answer? He knows tomorrow. We said something this week again that always inspires and encourages me. Nothing ever takes God by storm. Nothing ever just sort of blindsides God. He already knows everything in the future. So if you'll allow Him, how many of you know He'll let you in on what He knows and build confidence in your spirit because He is in charge as much as you allow Him to be? I want to say something today. There are times that we talk about the gifts of the Spirit, and those are powerful. We gave out during the conference a list of the 9 gifts of the Spirit. We gave out a list because we need to begin to walk in that power and that authority. It's not some weird thing. It's not some new thing. It's just walking in the blessings of the presence of God. And so the Lord began to speak to me this week. Sometimes the fruit of the Spirit is equally important to the gifts of the Spirit. Everybody say the fruit of the Spirit. How many know that it's good to have a tree if it has fruit on it? Not a whole lot of benefit for a tree that is barren. Amen. And we have to understand that God told us to bear much fruit. We're going to deal with that for just a moment. In verse number 17 of Galatians 5, flesh lusts against the Spirit. I want to say that again. Your flesh is fighting against your spirit. Well, I'm saved. I know that. But how many know, as long as you live, you're still going to have to put flesh under subjection. How many of you have ever been able to tell yourself no? Okay. How many of you wish you could tell yourself no? On the third piece of apple pie, how many wish you could say no on two? Or the extra icing. Come on, how many of you know sometimes it's hard to tell flesh? We're not talking about your body. We're talking about your carnal man. You have to tell yourself no, because there's a real you on the inside that wants to hear yes. There's a real you on the inside that God wants to hear you say, I want your will to be done, not what my flesh wants to do. Because the flesh is going to try to kill, steal, and destroy. Flesh wants to self-destruct. God spoke to Israel and He said, I'm going to set before you life and I'm going to set before you death. Choose life. Why would you have to say that? Because your flesh chooses death. every temptation out there is not to benefit and prolong your life, it's to abbreviate you. Every habit doesn't prolong life, it shortens it. So God said, don't listen to your flesh, listen to your spirit, and live. But I said, well, you know, the enemy's out to kill me. I'm not worried about the devil. Most of the stuff we attribute to the devil is just our flesh. The devil is defeated if you believe that, but you're not defeated yet. How many like to defeat yourself every day? So when you go home, get a magnet and write this word on your refrigerator, no. And you'll need to say that to yourself once in a while. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying this morning? Is this important? How many of you wish some people had taught you to say no to yourself before you got in the mess you're in right now? Because life is choice driven. We're going to talk about that in the next few weeks, because you're here today because of choices you made yesterday. Can't blame it on anybody else. I made the choices that I have made, hundreds of choices that got me here. One wrong choice, I wouldn't be here. And a few more choices, I really wouldn't be here. How many know it is true? So we're going to ask you this morning, if you will, to realize you need to allow the fruit of the Spirit to begin to work. Now, this is important because he is saying your flesh will crave to lust against your spirit and the spirit against the flesh. These are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do that the things that you would. In other words, unless you yield to the Spirit, you're not going to obey God. If you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest. They show up like this. Everybody say adultery. You don't know what that is? It's things that adults try. Okay, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, strife, wrath, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings. Sometimes you don't fit all the categories, but maybe one or two. Such like, and he said, of the which I told you before, in other words, I'm repeating this again, as I've also told you in the past time, that they which do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Well, I don't have to obey all that. Well, if you want to be in the kingdom, you can, because you can't bring that through the gate of the kingdom. In other words, if you bring that into the kingdom, you're going to mess up heaven. Sometimes we're talking about the kingdom on earth. You're going to mess up kingdom on earth, too. How many, there's just some things that you don't need to be hanging out with if you're going to enjoy your life. And there's just some things God's not going to let you bring into heaven to destroy eternally. Am I right? So Paul has repeated this about three different times to the different churches. But he said the fruit of the Spirit is love. How many of you know what love is? Have you experienced that? Have you felt it? Can you figure out where it comes from or how it works? No. How many of you had people that really loved you and then they quit? Look, real love doesn't quit. Well, I used to love them. I don't love them anymore. You are infatuated. I mean, real love lives forever. I mean, God is love, and he doesn't hang around for a month and then get mad at you and walk away. Or get offended at you. Come on, say amen. So we have to understand that love is one of the fruit. Not a gift. It's a fruit of the Spirit. If you have the Spirit, this is what you'll produce. Everybody say love. And joy. And peace. Forbearance. Putting up with folks. I said, you got me on love and peace, but I can't put up with people. Anybody have just that one person that gets on your last nerve? Just that one regularly? Stand up and tell it who it is so we can all pray. Get yourself in deep trouble. How many know God knows? How many know sometimes you might be the person that somebody else can't bear? I found out there's two or three people that don't like me. Out of about six, seven billion people, that's not too bad. Listen, folks, the way they look at me, I think they probably don't, but I haven't asked them yet. So one of the fruit you'll bear on your tree is kindness. Well, so that's not important. Oh, yes, it is. It's important to God. He made it one of the key gifts of a fruit. And goodness. How many like to share goodness with the world? How many like to have faithfulness? How many of you are faithful when it's convenient? Or you want to, but you want it from other people all the time. You know what I used to think when people were shouting, it meant I was really doing good? I found out when I'm really getting a quiet, folks, that's when I'm drilling something into their spirit. Amen? So nobody's shouting about the fact that we all really need to become faithful to God and to each other. gentleness. Well, that's not important. I don't think that's very important. How many know if you walk around and you're always OCD and you're always hyper and you're always bouncing off the wall and screaming about everything, and how many understand you need to just mellow out and become gentle? Amen. How many know the Lord is a gentle shepherd? Find one place where he screamed at the disciples. He screamed at the religious hypocrites because they were hurting his kingdom. But he was peaceful. Wouldn't it be great if the whole kingdom of God was just full of people that had gentleness? When's the last time you heard a message on gentleness? Probably be the first one. And then he said also, here's the gift, self-control. Against such things there is no law. I begin to look at this, and sometime back the Lord spoke to my heart, and he said there are people, I wrote this down, one of the most needed fruit of the Spirit is self-control. Say it, self-control. Nobody's involved with that but you. You can do that in a crowd. You can do it when you're all alone. Sometimes I'm by myself and I have to preach to me to settle down, calm down. Amen. Just let it go. Come on, say it with me. Just let it go. And sometimes I have to control what I would like to say. Amen. I would like to rage. Have you seen the picture on Facebook of the dog that's his face is all gnarled up and he's holding his mouth tight and he's having a fit? And it says, this is that look you get on your face when you really want to tell him off, but the Holy Ghost won't let you. I see that regularly in the church. And the Lord spoke to my heart. He said, fruit of the Spirit is often just as important as the gifts. Isn't it funny how most fruit is sweet? You'll get that halfway home. Somebody said, well, you know what? I got this bondage. I got this habit. I got this thing I'm involved in, and I just can't quit. Yes, you can. It's bigger than I am. No, it's not. Well, I just wish I could conquer. Yes, you can. If you want to, you can do all things if you'll let Christ do it through you. Well, I just can't control that. Yes, you can. Come on, if you write down anything about this word today, just say it to yourself. Yes, I can. Well, you know what? I just can't get a good job. Yes, you can. I can't be nice to my in-laws. Yes, you can. I can't be nice to the neighbor. Yes, you can. Because you can have self-control. It doesn't matter what people do to you. It's how you respond that changes your life. Well, people don't like me. Well, love them back. Well, that's not, I shouldn't have to do that. You're not just doing it for them, you're doing it for yourself. Did you realize that any bondage, any habit can be controlled by the fruit of the Spirit called self-control? And for that to work, you have to allow His Spirit to birth that in you. I'm not talking to everybody. I'm talking to the ones that allow the Holy Spirit of God to birth the fruit of self-control. You have to want the Spirit in you to control the things around you. How many of you can't do this without His Spirit? And if you want His Spirit, just ask and He'll give it to you. So there's not an excuse or a reason we can have self-control. When I looked at this, I realized we can have control over everything that we can't stop on our own. We can't do on our own. You can stop it if you'll let the Spirit of God give you the fruit of self-control. You can control yourself. I want everybody to slap yourself right now or talk yourself out of it, one. Who controlled that? You did. Now, don't be slapping on your neighbor. I'm talking about yourself. Because your neighbor's not your problem. They're their problem. You're your problem. Your biggest problem is the one that looks back at the mirror from, okay. Amen. Nobody's your problem but you. Well, the devil. The devil's a defeated liar. It's not him. It's your flesh that wars against God's Spirit. So, who are you going to allow to win? Well, God's going to win only if you let Him win, because He gives you choice to either let God control or your flesh. Anybody think we need to let flesh get out of the way? Not going to hold you all day, but I want to say this. There's a fruit that brings total deliverance. Wow. Would anybody like to be totally free all the time in every area of life? Some of us got a little bitty God, and we got Him all figured out. If you got God figured out, you ain't even got started yet. His ways are above finding out. The one that created the universe, the one that made life, the one that puts, okay, the one that puts hair and nerves in gnats and a bloodstream in a gnat. Someone said, how do you know they have teeth? Experienced it. Have you? How many know in the ark, Noah should not have let the gnats on? Or the mosquitoes. Come on, some of you are talking about rats and roaches. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about that little bitty stuff. How many know God had to put a nervous system in a gnat? So he's not just big that can create the universe. He's so small you have to put him on an electron microscope to begin to figure out the foundational tools. How many know God is bigger than what you think he is? And we've limited to think, well, he can only give me peace in church. He can give you peace at work. He give you peace when you pass by your neighbor that's cussing you out as you drive by. And you can just wave at him and pray for him and love him back. If you chose to. How many God's not going to make you? He's not going to slam on the brake for you and stop and say, pray for him, you devil. He's not going to do that. He's going to say, you know what I want you to do? Love your enemy. Love your enemy. You think that's ever going to catch on? Praying for those that despitefully use you. Bless those that curse. You think we're ever going to get there? We're not. I am. I can't do it for you. You can't do it for me. I got to make a choice. Would anybody like to conquer yourself enough so that you could bless your enemies? Bake a cake for the one that's messing with your kids and throwing rocks at your house and cussing your butt. Come on. Well, I'm just going to cuss them back and throw rocks back. Oh, that's going to work out real well. You think they're going to want to go to your church when they can hear you out cussing them? Just because you're a better cusser doesn't mean you're better at anything. When you got more descriptive words, that doesn't impress it. I'm preaching right now. Everybody say we must produce the fruit of deliverance. Now let's go to Matthew 17. And this is an amazing area, but I feel like this is very monumental for where we are as the body of Christ. Matthew 17, 14. And when they were come to the multitude, there came a certain man kneeling down to him. He humbled himself before the Lord, recognizing his deity and that he had power to do the miraculous. He said, Lord, have mercy on my son. Would somebody say, he's not asking for himself. He's not even asking for prayer for himself. Not a blessing for himself. He is praying for someone else. But so I don't know why we're here on this Sunday morning. We are going to bless somebody else today. I know selfishness is a horrible thing. If all your prayers are about you, me, just mellow out a minute, and before you pray for everybody else, pray for somebody else. Because what you sow in others, you'll reap it. No sowing, no growing. Come on. Old prophet used to say, if you don't sow it, God can't grow it. How many of we just need to sow for others what we need in our own life? You don't even have to ask for it. Just sow it and it has to come up. God said, as long as the earth remains, seed, time, and harvest. That's not about money. I'm sorry. That's all we've heard for 20 years, but that's not what it's about. If I sow kindness, I get it back. If I sow love, I get it back. If I sow peace, I get it back. If I sow it in my neighborhood, it comes back to my house. It works. Am I right? So let's recognize that God is simply saying, there is a fruit that we need to give. It's called blessing somebody else. So this certain man knelt before the Lord and called him Lord and said, have mercy on my son. For his, the translation in King James says, he's a lunatic. If you study the word, it means he is under the influence of, he's moonstruck. The reason they did that is because they thought this is a type of epilepsy or a type of self-destruction. Notice what is taking place. The enemy always wants to cover up that it's him by acting like it's something else. How many of you can't get a devil by getting struck in the head and becoming epileptic? You just don't get a devil by having an accident. Soak that in. And so they're confused about this, and the man is really describing his son, and he doesn't really know what's going on. It's a deceptive spirit of the true demon that is inside of there. How many know the enemy has three things that he loves to do, and that's kill and steal and what? Destroy. So if any of those three elements are going on around you, it's not your neighbor, it's the enemy. Everybody say the enemy. I love this verse 16. And I brought my son to your disciples and they couldn't cure him. Obviously, people knew that the disciples could pray the prayer of faith and bring healing. Wow. They had already been sent out. They came back with testimonies. He knew that your disciples, man, we've heard the testimonies from your boys. But I brought my son to your disciples, and they couldn't help him. How many know if you come to a place where you're not getting an answer, you might need to ask some more questions? How many of you in this house still don't know it all? The ones beside you with their hands down, explain the rest of it to them. See, know-it-alls know everything they're ever going to know. What a boring life. How many still trying to figure things out? Why, when you say hold the pickle, hold the lettuce, they add double pickles and double lettuce. How many know you don't can't figure that out? They double check it so they can get it double wrong. I'm just trying to help McDonald's right now. Have mercy on my son, because my son is a lunatic. He's sore vexed, which means he is vexed of the enemy. He's tormented. For oftentimes he falls into the fire and often into the water. Everybody say self-destruction. If something is taking place and the end result is always trying to take a life, it's always trying to destroy life. It's not happen chance. It's not a physical ailment. There's a spirit behind it. True? And so the man is just doing what he knows to do and what he's been told. He said, I brought him to your disciples. They couldn't cure him. And Jesus answered and said, oh, you faithless and perverse generation, how long am I going to be with you? How long will I suffer or put up with you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus said, I have some pills in my bag. 2 a.m, 2 p.m, they'll mellow you out. When that evil spirit rises, just calm it, tranquilize it. Jesus rebuked the devil. How many understand he had the power to stop the power of the devil? We don't like to talk about the devil, but how many, he's very real. Obviously, look around the world, he's very real. And what you think is working in people, economics, okay, politics. If there's anything that's not right, he's behind it. Every sickness and disease, he's behind that, trying to kill, steal, and destroy. Am I right? So don't pray about people. Pray about what's behind it. Amen. You have to realize that every one of us in this room are battling something, and sometimes we think it's a physical thing. It's not. It's a war in the spirit. There's physical things that you can deal with. You understand that. How many, when your car blows a tire, it's not the devil. It's a bad tire. Thou hast run over a nail, saith the Lord. But I ran out of gas. The devil made me run out of gas. No, you're too tight to stop at the gas station. Okay, just not going to be invited back. How many, sometimes we're rebuking the devil when we ought to be rebuking us? April, check the back door and make sure they didn't lock me in. He rebuked the devil and he departed out of him. Everybody say, he left him. The child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart when the crowd was gone, and they asked him, why couldn't we cast him out? We prayed, we did what we always do. And Jesus said, because of your unbelief. You know, one of the shocking scriptures, they came to the Lord and he said to them, how is it that you don't have any faith? Anybody ever feel when you're hit by a big battle that you wonder, don't I have any faith? See, faith is not really big or small. It's just real or it's not. He didn't say if you have faith the size of a grain of mustard seed, but like a grain. Though your faith seems small, it'll grow so big that birds can build their nest. In other words, you can make a house available, a territory for a house to be built by the bird kingdom if you'll just plant the seed of the mustard. So he is saying it's not how big it is if you activate it. Get your life planted in God. How many, if you get planted in God, he'll produce some fruit in you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. But because of your unbelief, for truly I say to you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say to the mountain, remove hence and go to yonder place, and it shall remove. Nothing shall be impossible to you. But so, brother, I want to move mountains. I don't want you to move any mountains. They're in a good place right now. If you move it, somebody's going to get their house crushed and their farm is going to be covered up. Leave it alone. You need to get rid of that mountain in you, that big thing in you, that thing that's hard for you to climb over, that thing that's an obstruction for your family. Everybody say, Lord, help me conquer my habits. Just 3 amens, that's right, and a hallelujah. That's okay. Howbeit, what he's saying, but let me clarify this. This kind of spirit goes out only by prayer and fasting. Read this all my life, heard my father preach it. And the Lord said, it's time for you to grab a hold of that and give it to the body. I want you to get this. There's sometimes we have to be willing to talk to God and put flesh under subjection. How many know fasting is not just missing a meal? It's being willing to put flesh under so the spirit can rise up over. Anybody have trouble fasting? Between meals? Some of you know Sister Woodson, her father was a minister in Corpus Christi, and we set a fast for the revival. We're concerned about, you know, some things we need to be praying for. So we had a three-day fast as we started the revival, and we were all fasting. It was amazing because by the second day, we would go in a gas station that'd say, you know what, we ordered extra hamburgers. Would you like a bag? And we'd reach out real hard, you know, till our joints almost came loose, grabbing for the bag and realize, no, we're fasting. We can't take that. Went to the next gas station the next day because we didn't get a lot of gas in those days, like a buck at a time. Remember those days? 50 cents. That's more like what it was, where you got like 2 gallons. Walked into the next gas station. They said, you know what? We ordered pizza. They brought us 2. Would you like one? I said, I rebuke you, devil. First service, we got to church, and I asked the young people, I said, how many of you fasted? And they said, we fasted till lunch, from breakfast to lunch. That is not a fast. That's a real fast. So why would I want to do that? Because it's a symbol that you're willing to put your flesh, your craving out of the way and focus on God. And while you're fasting, don't play, you know, video games. While you're fasting, pray. Everybody say pray. Because he said this kind of self-destructive spirit can be and will be aborted. Look at me. For somebody else. With fasting and prayer. Well, I can't make them. Only here does God say you have power to help somebody else. The man didn't say, I have the demon. I'm throwing myself in the fire. I'm trying to drown myself. I'm self-destructive. I'm suicidal. How many know every... Did I say it earlier? Let me reiterate. How many know every wrong habit is a form of self-destruction? It abbreviates life. You don't die, but a part of you. You're bringing on death early. How many know the enemy would like to kill you if it takes him 10 years or a month? He doesn't care. His job is to start the process so he can wipe out your life. And the Lord is saying here, I will give you the power over those around you that are in the spirit of self-destruction if you'll just fast and pray. Spirit of truth, I don't want us to lose anybody else to their habit. Let me just say this. You don't realize the power of an addiction. Well, I just would just stop. How many realize there's a control? There's a power, look at me, that's stronger than anything you've ever had to fight before. Why? Because once that spirit is allowed to be brought in, then it begins to grow and develop. It takes all the strength that you can muster to simply be willing to allow God to do what God can do. And the Lord spoke this to me so strong, I'm going to say it to you, and then we'll go home and decide what we're going to do about it. The Lord is simply saying, you can control the power of self-destruction, not in yourself alone, but in somebody you love. This man didn't have a problem. Somebody he loved had a problem. Does anybody love somebody that has a problem with slow self-destruction? The next question, and this is the next step. Are you serious enough to fast and pray? If this only comes out by fasting and prayer, are we willing to do what it takes? 3 yeses. I need some more. Well, Brother Young, you're going to ask me to give up gum for a week? Or Pepsi that I don't drink anyway? I know it really should cost you something. Amen? I'm going to challenge you, Spirit of Truth, and I have never done this in this way before because it's time for us to stop losing. Anybody believe this works? They laid hands on this demon-possessed boy, and they couldn't do anything because they're praying for his body. It wasn't his body. It wasn't a malfunctioning brain. It was the devil. How many know the devil has to move when you talk to God? But he said, this kind, this self-destructive spirit can only be removed by fasting and prayer. I'm going to ask everybody in Spirit of Truth to be willing to fast Well, how long? I believe God will show you that. I like for everybody, maybe it's a meal a day, maybe it's a whole day or 2 days. It doesn't matter what it is. You make a conscious effort to push back the plate. Are you willing to do that? Let me give you a scripture here as we're closing. Everybody say this is your second closing. Paul said this to the church in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. He wasn't there. He was not a disciple or follower yet. He was a follower killer at this time. And then the Lord brought a revelation to him later, and he was not a disciple at the very beginning. So by a revelation, the Lord had to tell him what happened at the Last Supper. I received of the Lord that which I also deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night when he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, take ye, this is my body. It's going to be broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after the same manner, he also took the cup, and when he had supped or taken a drink, he said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show or you remember the Lord's death until he come. I'd never seen this before, and I looked at it again, and I realized something. The Lord himself fasted a meal. Let that soak in. He fasted a meal. He gave up the bread and the wine that was the meal. What was the bread? His body. What was the wine? His blood. He gave up his body and his blood as a sacrifice so you can be free. If he could fast his own body, we should fast a meal. How many could fast a hot dog if it could deliver your child? Come on. How many of you could fast a meal if it would help somebody? Not yourself right now, but somebody else. Say it with me. Today we're dealing with somebody else. I never saw that so clear as when the Lord said, notice, it wasn't the man that was in need. He had a loved one that was self-destructive. And the Lord said, self-destructive, suicidal spirits, those bondages that come through the habits that are prematurely taking our life, this is the only way that spirit can be broken is by prayer and fasting. Everybody say it with me. It works, but it has not been tried. Anybody think I might be onto something here? Now, I want you to do something, if you will. I want everybody to stand to your feet. We're going to claim the promise of God today, and we're going to watch the power of the devil broken. We're going to watch the power of life take over, and we're going to give God some honor and some glory. I want you, if you will, just everybody, if you will, close your eyes as we stand together, and I'm going to ask if anybody in this room has not accepted Jesus Christ, come on down right now, because you need to have him living on the inside of your life, or you're already in a self-destructive, eternal damnation, doomed atmosphere that you need to break off. You are so loved. I thank God for the preacher that preached when I came walking down that aisle and said, I'd like to live forever. But I have to have the Lord wash away my sins, and I believe he paid that price. He gave me his body being martyred and his blood poured out so that I could be free from all my sins. You often say this, but every service, the time the doors are locked until we lock up for the week. You don't have to wait until the preacher invites you. These altars are always open, and we want you to come to him. It doesn't matter how far you've gone. It matters that you're willing to come back home. The prodigal son is given very graphically the torment that he went through till he finally woke up in the hog pen with the poverty all around him and death near him. He woke up and said, if I go back to my father's house, I can live. The Father's house is still available for us. Come weary, come broken, come hurt, come sinner. You just need Jesus. Well, brother, I don't know if I can live all that kind of Christian life or not. No, you can't, but he can live his life through you. I'm not talking about being perfect. I'm talking about falling in love with him, just letting him be the Lord of your life. If I'm speaking to you, please come. Please come. We take a moment every service because we realize this is why we're here. This is why just about 53 years, full-time ministry. We've traveled the nation. We've sacrificed every kind of a way that you can. Just so we can keep on asking people, would you like to freely live your life of eternity? Would you like to give the free gift of eternal life working? Would you like to give it to your children, your family? Salvation is free. But it's a choice. It's a choice. Well, I've got these bondages and I've got this stuff going on. God can deal with your future. Let him come in right now. He can heal you every place you hurt. He can restore whatever's damaged and broken. He can bring a new beginning. Many, many years ago, a wise preacher said something I've never forgotten. Why would you pass so close to heaven on your way to hell? Why would you come within 100 feet or yards away from an altar where you could live forever? The altar is not your salvation. It's changing your heart to follow him, accepting the gift of eternal life. I feel like peace is strong in this room today. There's people, your future is going to depend on the decision you make right now in this service, not just for a sinner, but for every one of us that are here willing to begin to step up and become a compassionate soldier of the cross. The Israelis fast every week. It's a symbol of what they did. I believe it would become a powerful thing from all of us if we would look around at somebody that we love and realize they're not going to be free unless somebody's in prayer for them. Somebody's willing to sacrifice. Somebody's willing to fast. And somebody's willing to touch God. Just look in your heart right now and ask yourself, am I prepared for my future? Am I ready for life to take place? Thank you, Jesus. While your head is bowed a moment, this is our final Sunday in the month of October. Doesn't mean we're going to stop praying for people. It's been one of the most amazing months of healings. Had some things happen this week where the doctors were giving horrible reports, and the Lord came by and said, don't believe that report. Ministered in a new location for the first time this week, and God gave me a word for a man that had recently had a stroke, and they were telling it's just going to take a little more stroke and take your life. I didn't know his situation, but the Lord gave me a word for him. I believe that's why I was there. One of the main reasons there, to remind him of a word of healing and a preparatory word, a protecting word. But the word is only good if you'll receive that word. The word is only good if you'll obey it. I believe this morning that the most important thing I can say is if you need a miracle healing, you just have to come into his presence. Some have got instant miracles this month, and others are feeling better every day. Their body is being restored every day. Organs are being made new every day. I think somebody today needs to come and receive your miracle healing. You need to come and take your life back. You need to believe that you receive that. It's the most important thing in the physical realm we can do is take back our life. That's what healing really is all about, is getting our health back, getting our life back. It doesn't matter what brought you down. The sacrifice of Jesus can put you back together again. Thank you for your presence, Lord. There's a strong anointing in this room. There's a strong fervor. Can I say this? Over the last couple of months, God has given warnings about life and death. Because of intervention, some lived that should have died. We're not talking about just one, but a number of people just in this area, in our churches. Father, I ask you this morning to comfort our spirit with truth. Awaken us to understand that there is a tempter out there that knows how to pluck our last nerve in weakness, to bow down to death and destruction in a moment of weakness. But Father, we also realize you didn't just give us this word because it's a cute word. You gave it because somebody out there that we love, they're self-destructive, and little by little they're dying. Little by little they're getting closer and closer to a destructive mode. And you're saying if somebody would pray, if somebody would care, as the Father cared for his boy that was thrown into the fire, thrown into the water to drown him or burn him up, the Lord said there's a victory that you can have if you'll just pray for me to do this, and then you'll fast and seek me, because it's showing you're putting your flesh out of the way. Somebody has to get involved in my ministry to bring life and restoration. So we claim that miracle. We claim that answer. We claim the completed joy. We claim the miracle power of the anointing. We claim life today. I rebuke the power of death. I rebuke the power of darkness. And I rebuke the power of the will of the enemy to kill and steal and destroy everyone that I love as this Father loved his Son. I love those that are in harm's way right now. I'm not just going to lay down and give up. I'm going to push back the plate, and I'm going to seek you, Father, in prayer. I don't know how to say it any other way, and I can't force this. I'm not going home with you, but would you pray this prayer with me? Lord, I will pray, and I will push back my plate. I will make it hard on my flesh. I'll notice what I'm doing because it costs me something. My prayer is more valuable because I'm more attentive when I'm fasting. I'm more focused when I'm fasting. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, there's miracle healing in the room if it's you. We're not going to close this on the last Sunday of this month, no. We're going to continue to pray for God to prove himself. There's people that would live the rest of their life amputees, but God has intervened. There are those that would be deaf, blinding, organ troubles. One gentleman, mother came and said, pray for my son. He's bleeding every day. He doesn't have hope outside of God. The medicine's not working. The doctors are not helping, but he's bleeding out. Got a report by the first of the week. The blood has stopped flowing. How many of you know that God has the power to rebuke the power of death and darkness? But somebody's got to pray. Somebody's got to, if you will, fasting is not just food. It's sometimes putting stuff out of the way that's more important than anything else to you for the moment. Put aside pleasure. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If you're in this room today, I'm just going to say it. Miracle healing is always available. We take this time in the service because God's put it in our heart to do that. We've watched wonderful things already happen. It's not just stopping in October. It's going to continue and become more powerful every day, every month, for the rest of our life. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Come on, everybody, just lift up holy hands and give some praise and honor to the Lord. Come on, lift up your hands, give him praise. I want to make this declaration. Many of the things that God has spoken to us about are things that are obvious. Some things are private. That's okay. But we will receive testimonies. We will receive glory for our Father. Can the body agree with me right now and say, Father, we speak life. We ask you to rebuke the devourer. You paid the price. Parasites have no right to attach to our body because we have been bought with the price. We're washed in the blood. We don't belong to the enemy. He has no right of way. So we evict him from the property. And this thing is stopped and turned around, beginning right now, for the glory of God. Come on, somebody say, I believe that I receive this right now. My sister's a part of my body, so it's part of me. I believe that I receive this with her and for her. Take away the threat of it, the torment of it, and the attack. It's broken by the blood and the name of Jesus. And for your glory. Let's clap our hands and give him praise. Amen. Come on, magnify his name. I love it when you can pray happy tears. Come on, the sweetest tears in the world are happy tears. I'm going to say something. I don't know how to do this any other way, but just be obedient. April, girls, would you help me for just a moment? There's something getting ready to take place today that I've been waiting for a long, long time for. How many of you think you got an idea what that really is all about? Anybody know what I mean? Now, I'd never heard this until the Lord spoke to my heart, and he said, I'm going to ask you to speak to my children this week to set aside a time of prayer and fasting. I just got to say it. I didn't see it until I heard it in my spirit. He said, this is my body and my blood in symbol. I gave up my body. I didn't give up a meal. I gave up my body, which is what you eat to live forever. And the wine that you drink of the spirit, so you live forever. The Lord said, I fasted my life. Can you fast a meal? Just bow your head a moment. I'm going to say it to you before we receive the communion. I want you to get a picture in your mind's eye of those, maybe one or several, that are self-destructive. They never thought they'd be in this thing. They never thought it would end up like this. But they're bound. A couple of years ago, we were at the high school, and the gentleman that's in charge of the hospital system in this area came and spoke to us. Some of you are there. He said, I want you to know that people, when they go in for surgery, Bayer Corporation created a thing called anesthesia so they could go under and not feel the pain of the knife. But when they came out, they were coughing and hurting and tearing stitches, and the pain was unbearable. So Bayer went back into study, and they added some supplements to that anesthesia. Now it's not called anesthesia. It is called heroin. That's why if you don't get off of it in the first few days, you're hooked. Does anybody expect to be hooked when you go in for surgery? No. Is it their fault? No. Did they ever think like that? No. But we have a nation of people more and more that are becoming hooked by medical prescriptions. How many know the enemy is very subtle? And once it gets in your spirit and the craving begins, we had a dear sister that came and said, I was off of drugs for a long time, and then I went for surgery, and the doctor could only give me so much, and my friend said, I know where I can go to the street and get you what you need. And she said, I became hooked again. How many know the devil is a liar? He's out to kill and steal and destroy. So don't be blaming people by pointing at them. Pray for them and fast for them. How many know we're not here to put anybody down? You have a weakness that I don't have. I have a weakness you don't have. So stop pointing at each other and let's begin to seek God in fasting and prayer and allow the presence of the Lord to have its will. How many of you right now can say, somebody on my heart with a very subtle, destructive spirit. Don't mean it. Don't want it. But can't help themselves. God gave me the answer today. I'm going to pray for them. I'm not just going to ask a little mamsy pamsy do it Lord prayer. I'm going to seek God with my whole heart. I'm going to push back my plate and talk to God. And I'm going to claim the word of God. I'm going to go to the scripture and line up verses of promise and power and authority. I'm going to conquer the power of the darkness and tear down the enemy's walls and his stronghold, because God said if I will pray and fast, all of that self-destructive spirit will leave somebody that I love. I claim that in Jesus' name. I want everybody to come to the front together. We normally pass by, but I'm going to ask, would you help me for a moment as you pass by? Stay right here. I want the body to get connected. I want you to know I'm praying for you. I love you. I love your family. I love your loved ones. I love those that you love, and I want you to love the ones I love. I'm going to pray for your family. I want you to pray for my family. I'm going to intercede for those around you. I'm going to push back my plate with your name on it. I'm going to push back my plate because I care about somebody that's about to die. No reason they have to die. Because the body of Christ has authority and power to stop this thing if we're willing to fast and pray. God, I ask you today, stir our heart to realize this is the only fruit of the Spirit and the gift of the Spirit to conquer by the power of self-control and fasting and prayer. Break the shackles. Come up close if you will. Somebody in your life that needs this miracle of intervention. Jesus' fast was to give up the biggest meal ever. He gave up his own body. Notice when he broke the bread and he poured out the wine, he gave it to them. He gave it to them. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I want you to take it in your hand. Just everybody take it in your hand and hold it. Several times in the last year, God has spoken to my heart, don't break it open here. Don't eat it here. Take it home. I want you to listen to me, body of Christ. I believe that God is going to bring somebody that's bound to your house. And you're going to take the meal that Jesus fasted, gave up. The meal is his body, his word, his promise, his life. The first time I obeyed this, a dear mama went home to her father, a very angry man. She gave him the message of Jesus Christ, and he accepted the Lord that day. Why? Because somebody pushed their flesh. They fasted their flesh will and way. They could have gone somewhere. They could have had a dinner. They could have just had pleasure that day, but they sacrificed time. Praying for the father, God saved him. I want you to take this home and ask God to just remind you this week of what you've made a covenant to do. Does anybody in the house believe this word is true? Do you believe the Father was concerned because even the disciples couldn't help them? Wow. We're not talking about some faith healer. We're talking about Jesus' ministry. And he said, that's because this kind is broken by prayer and fasting. Don't have to raise your hand, but how many would nod at me and say, preacher, I'm going to pray this week for those that can't help themselves. How many of you will push back your plate How many will make it a sacrifice? We're not talking about just a snack. We're talking about make it have importance. How many know we're not going to starve? But our flesh will certainly tell you. How many understand? We need to know that we got power over our flesh. Come on. You can do this. Bow your head. Father, come on, pray these words with me. What I hold in my hand may be the most significant item I've ever held to remind me that you fasted your body and your blood so that I can pray and with simple fasting stop the power of self-destruction for somebody I love. As the Father loved His Son, I love those on my heart. I don't have to lose them. I can do this. You spoke it as the way for the deliverance to be complete. I believe you. You created this plan of fasting and of prayer. I will be involved. Remind me, Father, every day this week that I have made a covenant which can be somebody's deliverance. Not just one, but everyone. Father, bring to our mind the ones that we need to pray for. And Father, let us set aside at least a meal for every individual we're seeking deliverance for. Be easy for a day. Be easy for several meals during the week. But Father, your Spirit will guide us. Thank you, Father. One final prayer. Father, I expect for the word to come alive in me so that it can come alive in them. Somebody that doesn't even know I'm praying. They don't even know I'm fasting. But I love them enough to do what this Father heard Jesus say is possible. And as that boy never again threw himself in the fire or tried to drown himself. Self-destruction and the spirit of the devil is broken this week for your glory. Thank you, Lord. I don't want you to clap your hands or you'll throw juice all over the room, but everybody say amen, amen, amen. Go over to your neighbor and tell them they're getting free this week. Expect a phone call. Expect a text. Come on, stay off Candy Crush so that you're iPad is free for a good instant message. Come on, somebody say, this works. Look at me. Has the Word of God ever failed? Can I ask you a hard question? Have you ever heard this before? Why? Because it's time. Well, they won't let me in the house. You don't have to get in the house. You got to stay home and pray and fast. God will go in the house, and God's going to deliver the self-destructive spirit. Am I right about this? Everybody say, self-destructive spirit is broken. If you will, just say it out loud. I believe. Let me remember this key for the rest of my life. For your glory, in Jesus' name. Everybody say, self-control starts with me. I got the power. I can pray. I can stay away from food. Oh, that wasn't easy for you to say it, but how many of you can step on the gas right past McDonald's? Even White Castle, you can avoid White Castle. Pete, you don't even have to do White Castle this week. Amen. Turn around to somebody, just smile at them and let them know you're going back to your seat. They're welcome to sit by you. Amen. You may be seated this morning.